Championship Wrestling, bringing you great wrestling action sanctioned by the NWA, the National Wrestling Alliance.
And World Championship Wrestling is back on the air. Hi, everybody. Tony Schiavone, Jim Ross, and David Crockett. Ringside with the NWA, the Major League of Professional Wrestling. As you know, and as you saw Wednesday night, Miami Mayhem was really hot right here on the Superstation. But, David, I know the summer's going to be even hotter.
That's right. The Great American Bash is going to take the nation by storm.
It really is. Now, as a result of what you saw, by no means is the issue settled between the Total Package Lex Luger and Nature Boy Ric Flair. And, Jim Ross, you were really close to that situation.
Well, Tony, I think basically what we have here is the fact that the battle lines have very clearly been drawn. There's a lot of tough guys on one side of the fence, a lot of tough guys on the other. They're going to settle it this summer during the Great American Bash. But as I told you fans this past Wednesday night, we would either have a videotape report on Lex Luger or have Lex here in person, and that's what we have for you today. And I'll be talking to the Total Package a little bit later here in our program.
There's another situation, David, talking about Barry Windham and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes.
That's right. It's the student and the teacher. Tony, what's going to happen with that?
I don't know exactly what's going to happen, but we do know that in Baltimore on July 10th, as part of the Great American Bash, the student against the teacher for the U.S. heavyweight title. There was a confrontation recently down in Savannah, Georgia, that really brought this out in the forefront.
Exactly right, and it's really amazing to me how Barry Windham can completely do a 360 and turn his back on a man that has taught him so much, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes.
Well, Dusty went out and made the challenge, and the challenge was answered. I think we need to take a look at that right now. Let's take a look at Barry Windham and the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes.
I am not afraid of Dusty Rhodes. Dusty Rhodes was a catalyst for the... He was the reason that I am a horseman. Dusty Rhodes, you know good and well why I'm where I am at. I'm the best at what I do. You can come out at any time. Come on. You come on.
Talk you out of this, but I'm going to have to start taking care of this business myself.
I'm telling you, you better stay out of my business, Dusty. I don't care what they say. I don't care what anybody says.
Barry Windham was slapped Dusty, and Dusty now is on his case, Jim Ross. He went tearing after him. Slams him into the post. The horsemen are here. Dr. Death and Nikita are here.
Dr. Death, Steve Williams, Nikita Koloff, Sting, Rhodes, all in the ring. And there are the horsemen on the other side, outside the ring.
Dusty Rhodes said he was going to settle it with Barry Windham. You can see his whole things. This is a war games environment. Baby, it is hot in Savannah, Georgia tonight. Windham is seething, and Rhodes is ready. The sides have been drawn.
When this fine athlete comes out here on the Superstation, as the old cliche goes, he holds court, doesn't he?
He certainly does. He's a tremendous athlete, the Stinger. He'll be taking on Rick Allen here on World Championship Wrestling. He's getting us all pumped up here. No doubt he is quite ready. There you see Butch Patrick. One of your favorites when you were growing up, Eddie Munster.
That's right. It's great to see him here with us in Atlanta. On the Superstation, where all the stars are. We're talking about the major stars in our sport, such as this man right here, Sting. You know, 1988 certainly is not over. We're just at a midpoint, so to speak. We've got a lot to go with the Great American Bash kicking off later in this month on June 26th. But so far for Sting, he has had 5 months in this sport that some people never have in a lifetime.
You're exactly right, and I think we have yet to see his very, very best. He's going to... Of course, to keep improving and getting better. He is just a great athlete. Look at this young man. He's a Stinger fan. I tell you something. I know all around the country, I know we're going to be in Albany, Georgia tomorrow night. Big national television is spectacular. I know we're going to see some fans there that will have their face painted like Sting. We're seeing it all over the country now. He is really taking America by storm.
You're right. That's a good point. Youngsters and families alike have taken to this guy. And the reasons are simple, because of the charisma he has when he's in the ring, but more than anything else, his ability. Sting has given us some of the greatest matches in the world, and he will continue to do so as the Great American Bash continues on this summer.
Well, I'll tell you something. He's one man that is certainly standing solidly with the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and Lex Luger, Dr. Nasty, Williams, the Road Warriors, Nikita Koloff, and many others. They are not intimidated mentally or physically by the Four Horsemen and their colleagues. And speaking of Gary Hart, Kevin Sullivan, Jim Cornette, and their people, it's going to be a very, very intense summer. The lines that we've talked about, the battle lines, we've used these analogies. Well, it is very clear now that we have two different factions, and they are going to settle their situation, not in a boardroom or not at a debate, but in the squared circle in some shape, form, or fashion this summer.
Place to get it done. Sting working on the arm of Rick Allen, still pulling on it, dragging the man down, and coming up with an arm bar. So powerful, but also so quick. Sting, certainly, as you said, Jim, on the side of Dusty Rhodes and Lex Luger. And even though we saw what happened outside and you witnessed between Luger and Flair, I know, and I know you'll be talking to him a little bit later on, that as we said before, that situation is by no means settled.
Well, you know, Tony, I've been around the sport for quite some time, and I've seen some very intense confrontations between great athletes in the past, but I've never been so close to a situation. I mean, you're used to seeing the physical nature of professional wrestling, but not like that. That wasn't wrestling. Oh, yeah. That was a mugging. That was just nothing but a pure D 5-on-1 mugging, and just that's all it was. And it was a very uncomfortable situation for everybody out there. And Lex Luger, he's never going to forget it. And this young man that the Stinger just put the Scorpion on is not going to forget meeting this man either.
Your winner is Sting in our first event here today. Let's take a look one more time at exactly what happened. Throwing the man into the corner, David Crockett's making his way over there at ringside because Dr. Dusty Williams has joined him in that blind move across, and then it's all capped off by the Scorpion Deathlock. Your winner is Sting, and he's with David Crockett at the ring, and the doc is there also. Let's go there.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, two men that are an important part of the Great American Bash. Dr. Dusty Williams and the Stinger.
You know what? You know what's important as far as I'm concerned? Is it okay if I talk to you through the ropes down on one knee like this or what? Okay. One thing that kind of bothers me, and not just kind of, it really bothers me, and we're talking about revenge in the bashes. You know what I mean, Doc? You saw the tape. I saw the tape. Four of you thugs. All of you, oh, should I say four like this? All of you on the total package. What are you guys thinking? You know there's going to be some revenge. I'm going to get even. I've done it before. I'll do it again. Excuse me while I just crawl through here. Get a little bit closer. Yell a little bit more. Show a little bit of veins coming through my neck and my chest to show you the way I feel about that. Nature Boy and all the rest of the horsemen, you guys, I can't even say what I'm thinking, but we're going to get even with you. That's for sure.
You know, David and Sting, he's fired up right now. You know, this incident, what happened the other night, reminds me of the old college days when all the boys go to the water hole. You don't have a few drinks and cocktails, but one of them's a little late. So the gang jumps the boy. And let me tell you something, the Four Horsemen, you know, I've been in a lot of brawls. I've been in a lot of fights. And I'm breaking up a lot of fights. But the Four Horsemen, you've got my attention. You've got the Stinger's attention. You've got the Road Warriors. And you even got Dusty Rhodes.
If you will. Publicly,
so,
if you will.
That's it, that's it. The Great American Bash is coming right down to the wire now. You boys, get geared up. Because the Sting and Dr. Death
is already geared up. Go ahead. Didn't mean to interrupt. Go ahead.
You got me so caught up, tongue twisted.
Well, so am I. I get that way all the time. Wind it up there, Stan. I feel like winding Flair's face up.
All right, they're talking about Lex Luger and the Four Horsemen. Listen, coming up next, the World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair. We're going to talk to him.
The situation, which we've talked about a couple of times, Ric Flair, Lex Luger, right outside of the Knight Center in Miami. It happened Wednesday night. And Jim Ross, it's appalling. We were all really in shock as to what happened.
I'll tell you, I was very afraid for Lex Luger's safety in that situation. You see wrestlers take a real beating in the ring. We've seen it right here many times, with guys like Sullivan and the Horsemen. But that situation was very, very scary. On the concrete, they were abusing his body. We got a piece of videotape that's going to remain in the minds of the fans for a long time to come.
Okay, let's take a look at it.
A few words with a total package, ladies and gentlemen. Without a doubt, he has the opportunity to make wrestling history on Sunday, July the 10th at the Baltimore Arena. Lex,
hey! Come on!
Hey, come on! Get some help out here! Come on!
Wait a minute!
Stay back! You better stay back!
Somebody get some help!
You know, I'm not going to say that we haven't seen that before, because we have, but I think if we go back earlier in the day on the Blackhawk, you had Blackhawk, you kind of alluded that something like that would happen.
Well, you're making it sound as if this act was totally premeditated. There's a couple other points that I think are more important. Number one, whatever took place happened outside the arena. So for once, the hands of the National Wrestling Alliance are tied. This is a personal issue between Lex Luger and the Four Horsemen. And what happened, frankly, did get a little bit out of hand, because what we wanted to do was to confront Lex Luger and just explain to him one-on-one what he was getting in store for on July 10th. And it was Lex Luger himself that precipitated the act by fighting as he did so violently and keeping the Horsemen from confining him where we could have a few words with him. So actually, it's his own fault that the whole thing happened. And if Dusty Rhodes and the Road Warriors and Dr. Death and Sting and Nikita and anybody else that wants to stand up, if they don't like it, that's tough.
You know, Luger used to say to me, he'd say, "Nature boy, when I was playing football, one of the real highs for me and all of my teammates was to hear you say, 'Now we go to school.'" Well, you see, Luger, what happened to you in Miami, Florida was, it was school time, it was an education. And now, Luger, you see, I got one here. It doesn't bother me a bit, because I know that to be a stud in this sport, you got to pay the price. And you see, what's upon us right now is the Great American Bash. Luger, you and I in particular have got a date in Baltimore, Maryland on the 10th of July. But preceding that, and God only knows, I don't want to be there, but have I got to be in the war games? Have I got to be in cage matches leading up to it? Then, pal, you better remember one thing. The Horsemen, the Powers of Pain, the Varsity Club, they're all my good friends. They all thrive on the blood and guts that make you a man in this sport. And the bottom line is, pal, that you and Sting, oh, Dr. Death, the watering hole was nothing, pal, compared to what you're gonna understand. You see, Sting, look at Luger. He won't show you proudly, but they tell me he's got 20 stitches in that eye. 20 stitches, pretty boy. Sting, you're next, because I'm telling you that in the 30 days between now and July 10th, Dusty Rhodes, Sting, Nikita, Dr. Death, the Road Warriors, you all will find out firsthand why this is synonymous with world championships, with greatness, with financial success, because the bottom line is, and this is the most serious thing that I've ever said to the public in my entire life, I live and die and breathe each day of my life for this business. I've gone through women, I've gone through cars, I've gone through bankruptcy, I've done it all to be the best. And Luger, July 10th, I'm gonna hit you, I'm gonna break you, I'm gonna squeeze you. And boys, let some of them say it right now. Woo!
Fans, Lex Luger is here today, and Jim Ross will talk to him a little bit later on. The U.S. Heavyweight Champion, Barry Windham, along with JJ, against Curtis Thompson. And really, we don't need to expand any more on what Ric Flair said, but he basically summed up his feelings and the intensity that's leading into this summer.
Well, I'll tell you something, you know, Flair has a lot of self-confidence, but sometimes you gotta wonder. He apparently has spent a lot of long hours thinking about the battle between he and Lex Luger on July the 10th in Baltimore. And we know that he has a wealth of self-confidence, and rightfully so. He is a tremendous athlete and perhaps the greatest world champion ever in the NWA. But the ultimate showdown for the heavyweight championship of the world on July the 10th has definitely got the Nature Boy thinking. The package, Tony, 6'5", 275, and now he's down, but he is not out, and he'll be out here a little bit later. And I'm going to be talking to him live here on the program.
We certainly are interested to see what he is thinking, because Luger, there's a right hand up against the side of the face. Luger has really, even though he is one of the premier athletes in our sport, has really gone through a lot this year, Jim Ross, with what has happened with the Horsemen and the split when he was a member of the Horsemen, and they really not liking the way he approached his sport, with what happened with Barry Windham in the midst of what we thought was the height of Windham and Luger as a tag team at their very best. It all goes downhill. And now for this to happen, it's been a really good and bad.
Oh, what a move by Barry Windham. It's been a very emotional year for Lex Luger, no doubt about it. But that emotion will have to come to a peak on July the 10th. And I'll tell you something else. I said this publicly, talking about emotion, but long before Miami Mayhem, long before we saw Barry Windham do the American Dream Dusty Rhodes, I made a statement that that match between Windham and Rhodes for that championship right there was going to be one of the most emotional situations that I'd ever been around in sports, because of the friendship and the feeling that those two athletes had was something special. It wasn't just a normal friendship, an acquaintance. This was special. And Windham just turned his back on that friendship from the American Dream, so they will settle theirs man-to-man, one-on-one in Baltimore for the United States title that I might add, and she pointed out, Tony, that Dusty never lost.
Windham hooking on Curtis Thompson. He has done everything except pin the poor man. A high vertical suplex took him over, and Barry Windham with that black glove on the right hand. There is no doubt he is prepared, but there is no doubt, like you said, Jim, there's deep feelings that run on both sides. And as much as Windham wants to put up the front, I know he's a solid horseman, and he's doing their thing right now, he has to have some feeling still for Dusty Rhodes, you would think.
Well, one would think that, but right here is the superplex by Barry Windham. Curtis Thompson will be in Never Never Land for the next few minutes after that one. Surely to goodness, Windham's going to pin him here. Windham has really gotten, look at, he and JJ are so proud. The guy's got to be proud when it takes five men to jump somebody when their back's turned and beat them up. I don't see how you can be proud of that. And these, you know, there's a few fans here cheering Barry Windham, mostly girls. He doesn't care anything about the fans. He's a horseman. He cares nothing about the fans whatsoever.
The lights have gone out for Curtis Thompson fans. And for Barry Windham, I know he is thinking of Dusty Rhodes, thinking of July 10th. The man never lost it. And he'll go up against the man who has it, the U.S. Heavyweight Champion. Here is the Flying Lariat one more time, fans. Exploding on Curtis Thompson, your winner, the U.S. Champion, Barry Windham, preparing for July 10th. And the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. He and JJ with David Crockett right here at ringside.
United States Heavyweight Champion, Barry Windham, a man that has true confidence in anything he can do.
The man is extremely confident, but as you can see on today's program, everybody is talking about the Great American Bash that's sweeping all across this country. And right in the thick of it, of course, is July 10th in Baltimore. That is a night of particular importance. But every match leading up to the Great American Bash is important. I don't care if it's this coming Monday in St. Martin in the Netherlands Antilles. I don't care if it's Tuesday in St. Thomas, if it's the rest of the week, wherever it happens to be, because the NWA stars appear all over the world. But all roads eventually are leading to Baltimore on July 10th in what will be, Barry, the greatest test of your life. But when you meet Dusty Rhodes, you will be prepared.
You know, I'll tell you what, I love the Nature Boy when he comes out here and gets fired up like he was just a little bit ago. You know, when I used to have to face him, when I would see the Nature Boy get bent out of shape like that, when everything was on, it's like he said, I got butterflies. It made me a little bit afraid when the Nature Boy eyeballs were gouging out of his head, because everybody out there knows that the Nature Boy means business. Lex Luger, when you see the Nates like that, you better be prepared, because he means business. Now, Dusty Rhodes, let me tell you, as everyone out there knows, and as I have said time and time again here on national television, I am not afraid of you, and what you have taught me is minuscule compared to what the horsemen have done for me. The four horsemen stand for excellence. Since I have been a horseman, I have had the United States Heavyweight Championship, I've had more money, I've had a lot more things in life that I can appreciate. And Mr. James J. Dillon has helped me do that. So Dusty Rhodes, don't think for one minute that you are gonna take anything away from me, because the United States Heavyweight Championship is on the line on July 10th in Baltimore, and you and I are gonna go in there with one thing in mind. The championship is not gonna be what you and I are wondering about and what we're worrying about. You and I are after each other. And Dusty Rhodes, your time is about up. It's time for you to move over and let the new kid in town take the wheel.
All right, July 10th in Baltimore. It's gonna be some action. More to come right after this.
Dr. Death Steve Williams, the man we heard from earlier in our telecast, going up against Trent Knight. Barry Windham is prepared. There is no doubt that Ric Flair's prepared, but this is a man, and he had a chance to sit down beside of me, Jim, during the Miami Mayhem telecast Wednesday night. And there's ever a man alive that I would really be afraid of to have on my bad side, it would be the guy.
Oh, no doubt about it. You know, Tony, I was in Oklahoma City yesterday, and of course, that's Dr. Death's stomping grounds, and there's an establishment there called the Red Dog Saloon that is basically a shrine to Dr. Death Steve Williams, because he has restored law and order in that eatery and drinkery on more than one occasion. The doctor, who's got a heart as big as all outdoors, I mentioned before, he spends a lot of time with the kids from the Special Olympics. His heart will harden on starting on June 26th in the Great American Bash. He is one nasty hombre, and I'll tell you something, you're right. You don't want him on your bad side.
Oh. He picked him right straight up and threw him right down. Now, he does have a big heart, but there's no love in it right now. You can tell on the face that the doc is prepared for war.
I thought Trent Knight was leaving. I thought he called a cab and was headed out to Hartsfield.
Probably at one time, Trent Knight was thinking about that. He reluctantly gets back in. And when you go to war, you want to make sure that everybody is, well, in the right frame of mind. There's no doubt. If Lex Luger looks over the situation, looks at his friends, he knows from what he has seen so far here today on TV with Sting and with Dr. Death, the men are prepared.
But the thing about it is that Flair brought it a very good point when he said that, you know, if you're going to be friends with Rhodes and with Luger, you guys, meaning Doc and Sting, Road Warriors, Nikita, you're also marked men. We're going to do, you know, so there's obviously a hit list that has been compiled by the Horsemen and by Gary Hart and Kevin Sullivan, Jim Cornette. Apparently they've gotten together, and there's a hit list to eliminate some people from competition. Oh, great move by Dr. Death.
Yeah, to put it in a nutshell, it happened once, it'll happen again. You know it with the Four Horsemen.
And the thing about, how would you like to be able to go to work, you know, like the fans, like going tomorrow night, Albany, Georgia. You're going to go wrestle. You got to look. When you get out of your car, you got to start looking for people. When you go to a restaurant, you got to start looking for people. I mean, the atmosphere has gotten so tense, and we've gotten a little bit away, I think, from actual athletic contests. We're looking at people at Pier 6 brawls and going nose to nose and selling things man to man. That's the way it's done in the NWA.
That's what stands it apart for the rest. Athletes like this man right here, the Doc. As Trent Knight tries to pull on that big arm, a 280-pound solid man. And Trent Knight gets shoved away. You saw that one coming. The Great American Bash is going everywhere. Some of the greatest events in the world this summer, Jim Ross.
You're exactly right, Tony. And, of course, I do want to remind the fans in Charleston, West Virginia, that this Friday night the Road Warriors are going to be back. They're going to be headlining an all-star card this Friday night in Charleston. And, of course, 1 week from tonight, what a great wrestling city Philadelphia is for the National Wrestling Alliance. 1 week from tonight in Philadelphia. I mean, that card is red hot from top to bottom. Four or five big main events 1 week from tonight in Philadelphia. Don't miss the NWA.
We have some more special announcements about that card coming up later on here today on the telecast, so stay tuned for that.
Big Dr. Death, Steve Williams, who will be headlining several of the Great American Bashes. I know Dr. Death has a match signed with Mike Rotunda for the World Television Championship. Dr. Death down in that four-point stance, perfect stance, his back straight, extends those legs. He is such an explosive athlete. And Dr. Death, I know, really looking forward to the 4th of July in Dallas at Reunion Arena, where he'll be teaming with Sting.
Caught him. Trent Knight has him up. Here comes the stampede. Oh, that's a solid man on top of him. And he puts him out. Yes, sir. Dr. Death is prepared, Jim Ross, for battle. He's thinking of one thing, and you're looking at what he's thinking of right now.
Can you imagine a one-on-one confrontation between Dr. Death and Arn Anderson? Would that be physical? I'll guarantee you that would be, as Barry Switch would say, a slobber knocker. And Dr. Death, he caught Trent Knight like he was a small sack of groceries.
And then with the Oklahoma Stampede, just putting him right through the mat, so to speak. Your winner is the Doc. Dr. Death, Steve Williams. Fans, when we come back, David will be talking to members of the Horsemen. Don't you dare go away.
The brave World Tag Team Champions, the men that jumped Lex Luger. Really proud of yourselves, aren't you?
You know, David, you amaze me more each and every week. Why don't you just hold the microphone and do what you get paid for? I'll tell you what, you know, we listen about Sting come out here and talk about, I'm going to beat up the Horsemen, I'm going to beat up Ric Flair, Arn Anderson, Tully Blanchard, Barry Windham, because of what they did to Lex Luger. Well, you know what, Sting? You better worry about what we're going to do to Sting. Because, you know, I guess maybe you were so distraught about what happened to Luger earlier that you couldn't go out there and wrestle up to your capabilities, because on national television, you had a chance to put yourself in the record books by beating Arn and myself with Dusty Rhodes as your partner. But no, you couldn't do it, could you? So you worry about Luger, and you worry about all this other stuff instead of worrying about yourself, because next, it's going to be 40 stitches in your eye, maybe in a parking lot outside Whisper some night. So, Sting, you take care of it, because we take care of business the way we do it best. Now, you want to talk about the bashes coming up? You guys want to get even with the Horsemen? Get in the War Games, big man! because we wrote the book on being bad. We're the baddest of the bad. At 4 a.m, we do everything better than anybody. It doesn't make one any difference what it is, any walk of life. We are the best. That's why we can do this. Luger, the good news is, in Miami, you look spectacular in that rented tux. You looked elegant. The bad news is, now you gotta pay for it because we ripped it to shreds. You see, Luger, this is not a laughing matter. Now, with 40 stitches in your head, you know what Rhodes has been through. You know what Flair's been through. You know what the rest of the horsemen have been through. You're not so pretty anymore. Your head looks like my head. But the difference is, I'm the one to go to Hollywood. This is what the horsemen do. That's why we're the world champions. Now, you want a gut check? Sting, Dr. Death, Road Warriors, Garvin's, Dusty Rhodes, Nikita. You really want to find out where you're at, gut-wise. Like Tully Blanchard said, you get into war games, get locked in a cage like an animal, and that's where you find out where you're at, gut-wise. And in this sport of professional wrestling, so David Crockett, I've said it once and before, Civil War 88 cranks up. You've seen a lot of intensity out of a lot of people. Well, you look at the enforcer, my man. I am Mr. Intensity. I'm going to take a lot of hurt out on a lot of people. The bottom line is, David Crockett, where the champion's going in and where the champion's coming out, he's going to show you why now. In a few minutes, I'll show you why we're all the best.
All right, let's go to the ring and Tully Blanchard.
Thank you, Dave. One half of the world tag team champions, Tully Blanchard against Dave Spearman. And regardless of what has happened and knowingly what's coming up this summer, the horsemen seem to be right now as confident as ever. And as we left the air the other night on Miami Mayhem, there was no doubt when we talk about the horsemen being the dominant force in wrestling, they were proving that to everybody right there in Miami and for a nationwide audience.
They made a very big statement to the whole wrestling world this past Wednesday night during Miami Mayhem. And I am really looking forward, Tony, to talk with Lex Luger live here on the program. Lex is going to be here, and there's some things we want to address. I'm anxious to hear what he has to say. He's had a couple of 3 days to reflect on his situation. Dave Spearman thrown right out here on the concrete. Tully Blanchard. Inverted atomic drop on the concrete. That is so painful. These guys have their intensity level and their love for inflicting pain has risen to all-time highs here. And we talked about the war games, two rings with it, surrounded by a cage with a roof on it. I don't think they have to worry about Dusty Rhodes and his comrades running or going anywhere. Even if they could, they're not going to do it. But nobody runs. Nobody can leave. 10 men enter and 5 men leave during the war games.
I have been fortunate to be able to see every war game that there has been. And Jim, we were both there for the one in Atlanta last year.
Right here last year on the 4th of July was without a doubt the most physical, the most brutal match I have ever witnessed in my entire life, anywhere.
Not only that, for the fans and for just you and I watching that day, the most exciting. There's no doubt about it.
Certainly was. And speaking of strange, bizarre matches, we've seen pictures of it. The fans are with us Wednesday night. The Tower of Doom, Kevin Sullivan is going to talk a lot about that. And it is quite something. Blanchard shows his recuperative abilities. He's got this thing well under control. There's no doubt about that.
The thing about Tully Blanchard is he always has it well under control. A smiling James J. Dillon, very proud of his horsemen.
So Spearman's all right. He's showing a little bit of spunk, and I like that. Something about this boy I like. Tully Blanchard beat him up last week. I understand he asked for a rematch. Kid's got some guts.
You know, the horsemen bring out the spunk in everybody, I think. Haven't you noticed that, the way Sting has been talking, the way Doc has been talking?
You have any?
The measuring stick. We all agreed upon that.
I'm going to talk to Lex Luger, JJ, here in the not-too-distant future here on the program. Any questions you'd like me to ask him?
No, not really. It's obvious that Spearman didn't see Lex Luger this morning, or he might not have shown up.
Well, Lex is a little worse for wear physically. But he is going to be fine, I can tell you that right now. He may be down, but he is not beaten by any stretch of the imagination.
Well, one thing for sure, after he makes his appearance today, the telephone lines between Hollywood and here aren't going to be burning up, that's for sure.
I'll tell you, that's the way they were laughing when they beat him up in the parking lot. in Miami. And then they had the plan work. The plan worked. And JJ says, it wasn't premeditated. Sure. So spontaneous. You just all happened to be there at the same time when his limousine pulled up. He has a hard time telling the truth, in my estimation.
You know, not only that, as Tully and Spearman go at each other, and Tully is really working the youngster over, there is a threat, of course, of Luger being the world heavyweight champion going up against Rick. And I think that is a viable concern of Flair's. But I think as far as the other horsemen are concerned, I think it runs much deeper than that as far as their feelings towards Lex Luger. Can't you just hear it when JJ talks?
The slingshot! Slingshot suplex, patented Tully Blanchard here. A great victory for one half of the World Tag Team Champions. No doubt that the Four Horsemen are at this time the most elite group in all of professional wrestling. And this man is one of the cogs in the machinery that makes it happen.
His name is Tully Blanchard, member of the Four Horsemen. There it is. Coming up in our second hour of World Championship Wrestling, a talk with the Total Package Lex Luger. We're going to find more about the Tower of Doom, and I know Kevin Sullivan's prepared for that.
Exactly right. I've got a lot of questions to ask Lex Luger. I think that, and he's got a statement, I think, to make not only to the wrestling fans, but also to the Four Horsemen here today.
And David, you'll be talking to Jim Cornette.
That's right. Listen, Kevin Sullivan's in the ring right now. Let's go watch him.
Okay, let's go to the ring. Kevin Sullivan against Bob Riddle, the Game Smasher, the wild, maniacal Game Smasher, who is prepared, yes, and who we saw the very last time here on Superstation TBS get Precious, try to choke her, and then after all that happened, look at this, after all that happened, she walked out behind him, Jim Ross.
Oh, man, the running clothesline right on the floor to Bob Riddle, and now Sullivan, that podium is a heavy wooden podium, and he is just wailing away at Bob Riddle, who is being beaten senseless by Kevin Sullivan. Listen to this. I mean, you can hear Sullivan beating him up.
Well, you can really feel Sullivan beating him up. The floor is shaking. If it can here at Superstation TBS, it really is. He went right to the camera that time, face first. He's calling Garvin's name. Of all that's been said, he was trying to choke Precious in Miami, and as Steve Dr. Death Williams ran in, she completely turned on everybody and walked out seemingly to go towards Kevin Sullivan.
This is a bizarre situation involving that beautiful young woman, and this triangle between Kevin Sullivan, Jimmy Garvin, and Precious is a very unusual triangle to say the least. And now he's got him out enough. Out here with the fans, metal chair. Riddle tried to put his hands up to protect himself, but no dice. Sullivan hammers away. He is almost on the brink of insanity here. And why would anybody want to get locked into a 40-foot-high cage with three levels, trap doors? I mean, it's like signing your death warrant. Jimmy Garvin better reevaluate his stance in this situation. Sullivan, this is Sullivan's dream match. He's going to... One thing about it, if Jimmy Garvin's... If he's not around, then makes the chase for the beautiful Precious a little bit easier.
You know, I'm not so sure that Garvin needs to be concerned. In the same light, even though Sullivan is like this, you have to realize what we have seen in the past here at the Superstation. Garvin should be even more so because of Precious, because of what Sullivan has done the last month or so to Precious and to what we thought was a great combination in Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin and Precious.
Kevin Sullivan showing the tremendous intensity that we've talked about the Four Horsemen. They don't have the franchise on intensity. Kevin Sullivan and his people, the Varsity Club, are certainly an intense group, of course, led by the evil genius. Now, Sullivan's biting Riddle right on the face. I'll tell you something, fans. This is the kind of action you're going to see at the Great American Bash. And, of course, we're looking forward to being all over the country this summer. And in Pittsburgh on Friday night, July the 8th, a great bash. And I do want to say that is going to be a tremendous, tremendous event. And in Chicago the next night, Saturday, July 9th, and tickets go on sale in Chicago this Monday. This Monday, get your tickets early for that one. They're going to go fast.
And that's the UIC Pavilion, fans, for the Great American Bash. Well, Sullivan. To say he is wild, we don't really have to describe what he's doing. You can see that when he gets in the rings, it's not your basic wrestling event. It is a brawl. It is a purpose to hurt somebody. Sullivan collars him with a clothesline, and now seemingly he has maybe toned down just a little bit, but not much. What else can he do?
He is a deranged man that is basically on a mission. And I'll tell you something, David's going to talk with him. I want to get out of here. I don't want to be around him anymore.
Same here. David, you can have him. And we'll take a look at what he did. And this was just the end of what was a brutal beating at the hands of the Games Master, the Tower of Doom. To say Kevin Sullivan prepared is an understatement. David, he's all yours.
Kevin Sullivan, the Games Master. I want to ask one question. What was it that you had that Petty wanted so much? What was that note? Was it a note, letter?
Yeah, it was a note. Goes way back. Let me tell you something, David Crockett. Everybody's getting ready, obviously, for July 10th in Baltimore. Ric Flair will die in the ring rather than give that to Luger. But I'm going to say something. Everybody has stopped telling the truth here on the subject with me and Patty. If you want to know why I'm so mad, it's real simple. She used to drive my car. She used to eat at my table. And she used to sleep in my bed. It's real simple. It has happened to every man in America. Some slime ball comes over and it starts for cocktails. And then it goes for afternoon tea. And then the next thing you know, she has moved out and living at another address. Well, Jimmy Garvin, I'll be damned if in Baltimore, in the Tower of Doom, it reaches to the ceiling. And yes, I devised it because I'm going to tell you one thing, Jimmy Garvin. You can take anybody you want. The American Dream, the Road Warriors, Lex Luger, and you can roll them up. You can roll them up and shove them where the sun don't shine. Because, Garvin, there ain't no place to hide. You took something that was very, very precious to me. And you mocked me by giving her the name Precious. Her name is Patty. And believe me, Garvin, in the Temple of Doom, you see the beating I gave this kid? It's cookies and milk. I'm going to take your eye and make a keychain out of it.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we have a station identification. We'll be right back. All right, Lex Luger, we've been talking about him. He's coming up next, right after this.
Ladies and gentlemen, this past Wednesday night, I witnessed one of the most violent acts I have ever seen in any walk of life, not just in professional wrestling. It happened right before my very eyes. I want to thank Lex Luger for being here in less than perfect conditions, Lex. Thank you for being here. I know you got something to say to the fans. First of all, how are you feeling?
I wouldn't miss this for the world, Jim Ross. Because you see, when I'm laid up in that emergency room of the hospital, God bless Jim Crockett. He's in one ear saying, Lex, I don't know what to do. My hands are tied. It didn't happen to me. I don't know what I can do. I said, Jim Crockett, I don't want you to do diddly squat. I don't want a suspension. I don't want you to take any means that would make me have to avoid the Nature Boy Ric Flair. You're not getting off that easy, Ric Flair. And I've got the police saying, Mr. Luger. Mr. Luger, do you want to press criminal charges? Hell no! I don't want to press criminal charges because you'll have one of your high-priced attorneys get you out in an hour. The sentence for the Nature Boy Ric Flair takes place in Baltimore, July 10th, and there's no getting over it anymore because you see, for a long time, Nature Boy, you made me wait months and months, and when you will finally face but the reality of this right here, you said yourself, what do I do? Well, you bring your thugs, your goons, to a parking lot. Well, that's great with four guys. But in Baltimore, You've got to walk that aisle this time. The rules are reversed. You've had a long career. You said you bled. You said you sweat. Well, this time around, you're going to bleed more in that one match. You're going to sweat more than you've ever have in your whole career, Nature Boy, because you're mine in Baltimore. And this time, you walk that aisle with that sick feeling in your stomach, because for all the time you made me wait, this time what you've done is you've just fanned the flames. You have lit a powder keg that you will not be put out. That belt means more to you than anything in this world. Well, Nature Boy, the Mick is saying from you, when you walk that aisle with that sick feeling in your stomach and it's churning, and you know that I'm waiting for you in that ring in Baltimore, baby, let me tell you something. You are going to be mine all night long, Nature Boy. And you're right.
I don't know. We've heard enough. It's going to be something on July the 10th. Let's go to the ring.
Tommy Angel awaiting one half of the World Tag Team Champions, Arn Anderson. And yes, it is as hot as it can possibly get in the NWO.
The minute ramblings of a frightened man. Nothing more, nothing less. You can't attack if you're looking over your shoulder.
Well, I'll tell you something. I don't agree with Arn Anderson. Lex Luger is not frightened. Lex Luger did get beat up, Tony, but he's right here today to face the world and tell him his side of the story. A lot of athletes wouldn't even been here. That's the first thing they need to think about. And number one is that on July the 10th, the Horsemen have got all they can say grace over without being able to help Ric Flair. It's going to be Flair and Luger one-on-one in the showdown for the heavyweight championship.
And, you know, that is the key word. You know, Jim, I have the utmost respect for Arn Anderson, for Tully Blanchard, for all the Horsemen, Ric Flair, Barry Windham. But Arn was over here after Luger left talking awfully brave, and he is a very brave man. But it's easy to talk like that when you know if you get a fight, it's going to be a gang situation, a 4 or 5 on 1.
Maybe they're trying to convince themselves that Luger's scared. Luger's not scared.
Look, now Arn is saying, do you remember this Luger? Sure he remembers, but he also remembers not only was an Anderson down on him, four other men were standing around him, for goodness sakes. It was nothing like that situation we're looking at right there. Nothing like it at all.
No, that's one-on-one right here. That's what we have. What we had the other day was a 5-on-1 situation. 5-on-1. And they're going to go around telling everybody in the world that Lex Luger and Dusty Rhodes are afraid of the challenges facing them this summer. I think what they're doing is trying to convince themselves. They're trying to convince themselves of that statement, and it is just not true.
Well, I tell you what, the emotion is so high out here, it's kind of affected us also. But one thing we do want to let you fans know, that the intensity, we've always said it, is so hot in the NWA, but we have never, Jim, I know you haven't, I have not, I have never seen it this way before, ever.
And Tony, that's what makes the upcoming events, the big event like in Albany, our first trip down to Albany, big national spectacular, tomorrow night, it makes that event mean so much more, because the fans around the country can see the attitude of these athletes. When the Road Warriors get back in town this Friday night in Charleston, West Virginia, you can bet they're going to be pumped up. The great fans in Philadelphia, 1 week from tonight, they're going to see a barn burner. These guys are pumped up. I don't know. You know, they talked about some people not making it to the bashes. That could be, from what Flair said, a very true statement. But when you look at the list of the hospital, you may see a name of a horseman or two in this situation, too.
Arn Anderson continues to tug on the arm of Tommy Angel. The situation is so explosive that any time, you know, we're looking to our right here because we can see someone tumble out of the dressing room here at TBS. You never know when it's going to happen.
And it's happened here before.
It's happened here before. We were down in Savannah, Georgia, with Dusty Rhodes.
And I went in the locker room.
You went in the locker room to do an interview.
That was a mistake.
He just went right into the, and you know.
That was a mistake on Rhodes' part. It was a mistake on Jim Ross's part for going in there. I didn't need to be in that environment, I'll tell you.
Dusty just went right into the dress room, and he just, as they say, kicked butt, and he took names is what he did. He went right out and continued in the ring. So you never know when it's going to happen. Luger could come tumbling in here with Flair. It just is that explosive, that intense right now. Man, no man is safe.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. That's why when we talk about big events like the Charlotte Memorial Stadium on Saturday night, July the 2nd, the 4th of July will never be harder than in Dallas at Reunion Arena, with the Tampa Stadium. What an event in Tampa, Florida on Wednesday night, July the 6th. Fans, this is really something. We really suggest you make your plans to be with us. And, of course, the fans in Chicago, their opportunity to buy tickets, will go on, they're going to sell this Monday in Chicago. Arn Anderson has slowed it down now, and he's a very methodical, sadistic individual. He may be the most, excluding Ric Flair, but looking at Barry Windham and Tully Blanchard, a lot of people think that Arn Anderson is the most intense competitor of the group. I don't think you can get any more intense than Ric Flair. I don't think that's possible. His comments today were vintage Ric Flair, tremendous confidence. And he's going to have all the confidence he can muster because it is his ultimate test on July 10th as well.
Not so sure as you take a look at what has happened. Ric Flair is the world heavyweight champion, certainly the greatest of all time, because we've seen enough matches in our career that know that when Ric Flair is at the top of his sport, there is nobody better.
No, you're right.
But still, with what has happened for the last couple of weeks, I'm not so sure if you can talk about him individually anymore. It's the unit that you got to deal with. When you deal with Ric Flair, you got to deal with the horseman as a unit.
That is a brutal maneuver, and he is so good at so many of those physical coup de grace type maneuvers. Double A Arn Anderson. You can bet that he will be geared up. It doesn't make any difference if it's inside two rings in a cage in a war games environment. Whatever it may be, this man is intense.
We take a look at the enforcer, Arn Anderson. A note to everybody there, our director, Tommy Edwards, assures me that the Spam Slam of the Week is coming up right now.
Spam Slam is brought to you by Hormel, makers of Spam and other grocery products.
On this week's Spam Slam, we take a look at Tommy Rogers, one half of the Fantastics, and showing why he's part of the U.S. Tag Team Champion. Quickness and power with a power slam. Tommy Rogers with our Spam Slam of the Week.
Spam Slam is brought to you by Hormel, makers of Spam and other grocery products.
We're going to talk, fans, right here about the Great American Bash, our Great American Bash update. We don't have to tell you anymore about the intensity from the athletes leading to the Great American Bash. We do want to tell you, though, that it does go all over the country, some of the greatest cities in the world, and also some of the biggest events. You heard Tully Blanchard mention, get in the war games. The war games, the match beyond two rings, enclosed by a cage with a cage on top of it, and they enter one at a time at two-minute intervals till all are in at one time. It is all-out war. Also, the Skywalker scaffold match is part of the Great American Bash, 20 feet above the ring. Jim Ross, it is really hot. But also cage matches and then also the Tower of Doom.
The Tower of Doom, quite a situation. It looks like a three-story building in my estimation. And the situation there is that two men will start at the very top of the cage, and there's trap doors at every level. But those trap doors only open every 2 minutes, and they're only open for 10 seconds. So you could see that someone could be caught in the cage, what could be a two-on-one or a three-on-one situation very, very easily. And that could be a very, very dangerous situation.
And the thing to do is to fight down through to the bottom cage and have your team escape and get out. That's the purpose of the Tower of Doom. But also Ric Flair, Lex Luger, you know about that situation. Dusty Rhodes and Barry Windham, that situation for the U.S. heavyweight title. But also, what about the Legion of Doom, the Road Warriors? We've not seen the Road Warriors the past couple of weeks here, but we know that they have always been prepared for the big events, and they've got one coming up against the team that's trying to destroy them, the Powers of Pain.
And you know, the match was signed. We've made the announcement as far as the match being signed on the Skywalker match between those two teams. If you think about that, you've got over 1,200 pounds, 20 feet above the ring. And we've seen a lot of Skywalker matches in our past, but never with four men this big and this massive that high up in the air.
And what has led to that? Well, a couple of situations. In January in Greensboro and then later on in Tallahassee. Let's take a look at what the Powers of Pain have tried to do to the Legion of Doom.
Chair.
We do understand that Hawk is recovering quite well and will be prepared for the Great American Bash. High above the ring, the scaffold 20 feet in the air.
Very dangerous situation. If you fall backwards, there's no ring. It's concrete floor, 20 feet in the air. 1,200 pounds is kind of scary when you think about it, that high up in the air.
Fans, another situation is the Midnight Express in the Fantastics and the Straitjacket, what we saw right here last week. When we come back, David Crockett talks to Jim Cornette, and the Midnight Express will have a match. Don't you dare go away.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're back. Jim Cornette, the Midnight Express.
David, that's a nice bed sheet you're wearing for a handkerchief today. Somebody told me Eddie Munster was here. I thought they were talking about Tony Schiavone with his mustache shaved off. Ladies and gentlemen, I present none other than the greatest tag team in professional wrestling. Remember, they're not good, they're great. Beautiful Bobby and Sweet Stan, the Midnight Express.
Tony, I haven't seen a sport coat like Cornette's wearing since Perry Como's show was taken off the air back in the middle 60s.
Get your words in now, Jim, because here it comes.
Oh, don't worry about getting no words in. I'm going to get them all in. Everybody's talking about the Great American Bash, the price for freedom. Everybody's talking about cages and bull ropes and bunkhouses and war games and scaffolds, skywalkers. The Tower of Doom. If you can't find it in the Great American Bash, brother, you can't find it in the dictionary because it just don't exist. I saw Lex Luger out here, got his head sewed back on like the Frankenstein monster. He's talking about getting even. Somebody ought to have told Lex Luger that if you walk on the streets of Miami, sometimes you can get mugged after dark. Barry Windham and Dusty Rhodes. Barry Windham said goodbye, Mr. Chips, to his teacher, Dusty Rhodes. He took the pebbles out of his hand, and it was time for the grasshopper to leave, and now Barry Windham has surpassed the teacher. Everybody's talking about the powers of pain and the Road Warriors. Two big, strong guys against two bigger, stronger guys. I don't know who's going to win, but I know one thing. There's an awful lot of strength going on in that ring when they get together, and that's not just their breath, but most importantly, we're talking about the Midnight Express, the Fantastics. Bobby Fulton has been answering the phone around his place a lot lately, and it ain't even been ringing. You know what happened? He got his head rung, brother, and he got it rung by beautiful Bobby right there, who swings to meet his chair since Paul Bunyan started swinging a logging axe. You saw it, Jim Ross. You know exactly what I'm talking about. And the Fantastics are wanting revenge. They're wanting back at the Midnight Express and Jim Cornette in a worse kind of way. Look at his teamwork. Woo!
Boom! You teach him that move, Jim? You teach him that?
Of course I did. You realize, in addition to everything else that I got on my mind, that I have been on a fitness and conditioning program lately. I've dropped a lot of weight. I'm cutting up. I'm bulking up. I'm on a high carbohydrate, high pectoral, low hostess Twinkie diet. As a matter of fact, I said after I beat Ronnie Garvin in the cage, I said after I tied a knot in Misty Blue's tail last time in Baltimore, I said I was never, ever going to wrestle again. But you know something? I may even have to wrestle here in the upcoming weeks, just to show people what kind of condition I'm in. Sweet Stan's been training me. He's got my bench up to 433 and a quarter. Do you realize that?
Ounces?
433 and a quarter. That's pounds. We're in America. And besides that, besides the fitness and conditioning program that I've been going through, the Midnight Express are in finer condition than they've ever been in their lives. They're ready for United States Tag Team Championship. They're ready for the Great American Bash. The price for freedom, I'd pay the price for freedom. I just don't know who to bribe. But it don't make any difference because everything's coming up in the NWA this summer, and I'm just happy to be a part of it. But there's a few things that I'm not happy about, Jim Ross. There's a few things that I am upset about that the NWA is trying to do to us. They figure the summer of 88, the Great American Bash, it's time to get rid of the Midnight Express. It's time to get rid of Jim Cornette. So they're doing everything in their power to stack the deck against us. They're doing everything in their power to give the Fantastics a shot at me. Do you see the blood in their eye, brother? They want me, and they want me bad, and they want the Midnight Express, and they're willing to do anything to get us.
You're very perceptive. You're exactly right. They do want you very badly.
You're very perceptive, too.
Thank you.
You also have a very big neck.
Wait, I'm on the same dot you're on.
They made us promise we wasn't going to break no furniture.
Yeah. Tony, do you have anything you'd like to say here?
You're doing fine, Jim. Go ahead.
My arm's getting tired holding the mic. Here, go ahead. You're doing great.
That arm would get tired holding anything except a fork. That's what it looks like it holds most of the time. You see,
that's
this
not
little,
very nice to say to
this
somebody.
Little bleached blonde punk right here, a suicide blonde, died by his own hands. He's finding out the hard way what it's like to get in the ring with the Midnight Express. That's the same thing the Fantastics have been finding out for months. But those punks, those little stinking geek punks, they won't give up. They won't quit no matter what we do to them, no matter what kind of hole we knock them in, brother. They climb right back up and they're looking at us again. They are like... they're like fungus on a shower curtain. You can't get rid of them. They're like finding out that the chemotherapy didn't quite take. They are the most persistent, without doubt, idiots. Look at this guy right now. Now he's trying to get smart. Holy body, get out of that corner. Hit him. There you go. The Fantastics are persistent above anything I've ever seen. You can beat their brains out. You can hurt them. You can bust them open. They'll come back. And they're still hanging on to those U.S. tag team titles, but only by a thread, brother. Only by a thread. Once Beautiful Bobby does something like this to him, it's going to be all over. Once Sweet Stan does one of his
martial arts. He's done it before, and it hasn't been all over.
Well, it's going to be all over this time. Take my word for it.
Sure. How about the...
Would I lie to you?
You darn right you would. You have
all... Well, you'd lie to me, too.
What about this? This is a nice white jacket, but the one that you're going to be wearing a little bit later this summer is not going to fit quite so nattily.
Jim, let me tell you something.
Mr. GQ here.
The whole idea of the Fantastics going out to the Cracker Box Palace and getting one of those long sleeve jackets to put me in is ridiculous. I'm not crazy. As a matter of fact, I've told you I'm not crazy. I got papers at home to prove it, brother. You could have the finest doctors in this country examine my head. You know what you'd find?
Nothing.
Nothing in there.
Absolutely nothing.
I'm going to tell you something fantastic. I don't know who came up with this idea, whether it was the NWA, whether it was Jim Crockett Promotions, whether it was David Crockett standing there, whether it was Tony Schiavone. Well, those ugly kids, don't wave at me, you smiling, grinning, geek-faced idiot. Whether it was anybody, I don't know who came up with the idea to put me in a straitjacket, but I'll say one thing for them.
It was a good one.
Oh, shut up, Jim Ross. What do you think we are, Abbott and Costello? I ain't giving you straight lines here. I'm stating facts. The fact of the matter is, I'm not crazy, I'm not insane, and I shouldn't be put in a straitjacket. And people all over the country right now, they're calling their local cable companies. They're saying, get us the Great American Bash. Bring it into our living room. We're going to sit down. We're going to drink beer. We're going to eat popcorn. We're going to watch TV. We're going to see it right there live where Jim Cornette gets slapped in a straitjacket and hauled up 50 feet in the air over the ring. Yes, you know I'm afraid of heights.
I knew that.
You've known me for a long time. Don't rub it in, Jim. Do not rub it in. They're going to watch me be hauled up 50 feet in the air over the ring like a daggum fishing worm on a hook.
Does your nose bleed when you get a little high off the ground?
My nose bleeds a lot anyway, I'll have you know. As a matter of fact, I've always been very susceptible to illnesses ever since I was a small child. That's why Mama never let me play with all the other kids.
You go hold your racket, Jim, if I may interject something here.
I know the Fantastics. They're talking about trying to find a new place for me to hold my racket when I got both my arms tied up in a straight jacket. And like I said, I don't know whose idea it was, but I can prove I'm not crazy. You got an idea, David. Well, it died of loneliness last week. That's what happened to it. Look at this right now. The Midnight Express doing the original rocket launcher. Brother, that guy is so flat, he could look up at a snake's belly.
Well, Tony, I'll tell you something. This has been an experience, I'll tell you. We've all been insulted. But the ultimate insult could happen on July the 10th.
We talk about great tag teams. Let me say right here as we take a look that Jim Ross, we found out Wednesday night that a special added attraction to the Great American Bash coming up this summer, the return of the Rock and Roll Express to the NWA. Great tag teams abound. And one of them right here, the Midnight Express, along with the Mr. Filibuster himself, Jim Cornette. Go to it.
You know what? I don't need any of your mouth, Schiavone. I'll slap a taste out of it in a second if you give me any more lip. Now, I'll shut up, you freeloaders. I don't need nothing from you anyway. I thought that the Fantastics would never want to look at a straitjacket again after what we did to them. We had them convinced we wasn't in the building, wasn't in the same state. I knew they'd give us an opening. I just didn't know it'd be all wrapped up like a Christmas package, but that's exactly what happened, and we capitalized it. I just couldn't believe that they could come back after it, and I didn't believe that they would ever want to see another straitjacket again. You know what I'm talking about. You got a piece of tape. I want to see it right now. I want everybody to see what happened to that goof Bobby Fulton.
Let's watch it. Once you put it on somebody, I know they're very, you know, not going to be able to move because it's so tight on my shoulders and stuff right now that it's getting tight. It'll cut your wind away.
I'll just put on a couple of them just to show the people.
Okay. Putting Cornet in the straitjacket.
Okay. What do you do with the arms now?
Yeah, what about the arms?
Okay, the arms cross in front of you here.
This way, right?
This way, right around here. And the strap comes around here.
Oh, my goodness.
Then what are you going to do?
Well, there you see Bobby Fulton.
Jimmy Cornette, yes.
It's pretty tied up in the straitjacket.
Can you imagine, David, Jimmy Cornette in this thing? And this goes back to the first tier.
Goodness.
Across the back here. And latches it in.
Hold it. Yeah, that's awful tight, man. I can't even move at all, man.
There's nothing he can do.
There's nothing.
Absolutely nothing. There is absolutely nothing that he can do.
I want to see where he puts the tennis racket.
The straps come down around the legs, too, so he makes sure he ain't going to get away for sure.
That's a good one.
Cornette, when they put you in that straitjacket, you can't move your arms. You cannot
anything. Bobby Fulton couldn't move his arm, couldn't move his leg, couldn't move nothing for a while. Let me tell you something. What beautiful Bobby did right there was try to fracture Bobby Fulton's skull. We had it all planned out. The design in mind was to get rid of the Fantastics and keep me from going in that straitjacket. And, brother, that's as close a thing as you'll see on TV to attempted homicide in a long time. But I'll tell you this, Fantastics, you're hot. You're mad. You got blood in your eye. You want revenge. You want Bobby. You want Stan, and you want me. Well, that's good. I want you at your baddest. I want you at your best. I want you at your toughest. I want you at your meanest, brother. Because when you get in that ring with the Midnight Express and they beat you, I want everybody to be able to say that the Midnight Express beat the Fantastics when they were at their very best, when they were hungry, when they wanted revenge, when they had that blood in their eye. I want everybody to be able to say that the Midnight Express were the better team when all those people all across the country calling those cable companies saying, get me this thing right in my living room just to see me humiliated. I'm going to turn the tables on them, brother. Because you're the ones going to be humiliated, Fantastics. I'm not. I may be hauled up there 50 feet in the air. I may be wrapped up like that in a straitjacket like I belong in a rubber room at the Puzzle Factory. But, brother, I'll tell you one thing. I'm going to have the best seat in the house. I'm going to have the best seat in the house to look down in the middle of that ring and see the Midnight Express beat you and take the U.S. Tag Team titles that they deserve, that they own, and that they should still possess and put them back where they belong, right around their waist. That's what I'm going to see, Fantastics. So just remember, I told you, that was only the start. We got more tricks up our sleeve where that came from. And if you make it to the Great American Bash, then you're going to have to pay the price for freedom. Only I don't think you've got that much money in your pocket. And I don't think you're going to have that much guts when you get in that ring with the Midnight Express. So remember, you're losing those titles. They're coming back to the Midnight Express. And brother, Fantastics, you said I was crazy. But Bobby Fulton, you're the one that ended up getting your head examined.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, listen, coming up later in the program, the Fantastics will be here.
Back on the Superstation, fans, you know, we've talked a lot about war this summer. There's no doubt from what we've seen and what we've heard, there is going to be all-out war this summer during the Great American Bash. But what about what we saw in Miami on Wednesday night? Certainly the classic match between two classic athletes, Nikita Koloff and Al Perez, along with Gary Hart. Gary Hart has made some accusations, said some bad things towards Nikita Koloff, and he said he'll take him in any kind of match at all. Let's take a look at what happened, what transpired in Miami between these two classic wrestlers, this classic match.
How much more can Nikita Koloff take? He has been brutalized within the last couple of minutes here. Gary Hart looking innocent while Teddy Long is looking at him.
Well, it's a struggle for him to get to his feet. It's taking all he can muster just to get back into the ring.
He's getting up though. A shoulder. He got it.
I thought sure he had him for the three. Only able to hold him for the two. Right now, he's back in trouble again. That's just how quick Perez can turn it around.
That's right. Give a lot of credit to Al Perez. He was stunned momentarily, almost lost the match that quickly, but he has stayed with his game plan. He has kept the pressure on Nikita Koloff. We talk so much about the greatness of Al Perez, and you know, it's really coming out right here on the Superstation tonight.
And, you know, I was thinking about Perez and Koloff, what great athletes they are. I got to go back. I was very interested in hearing what Lyle Alzado said about the athletes and about the wrestlers, how they compared with some of the football players as athletes, how great he thought the wrestlers were.
You know, it's Bob, and from working with a professional wrestler like you and I have had for so many years, we know that these men are on really strict regiments as far as workout is concerned. They travel a lot. They go into the ring and they try to settle their differences, try to control their tempers. Each and every day they go to the gym and they work out, and it's really a real rough life to lead. It really is.
There's no free time, no time of their own. It's wrestling really 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's what occupies them and occupies their mind. And hey, if you're going to be successful and if you're going to be a champion, that's what you got to do.
You ask guys like Dusty Rhodes, like Nature Boy Rick Flair, what has put them to the top? And that is total dedication to this sport.
Absolutely.
And that's what separates them.
Without that dedication, you'll never make it. And that's what separates the champions from the others.
Right now, you're looking at two men.
Who's going to lift him in the air?
You know, it's, and the Koloff is down also. You talking about champions. Koloff pulled that from seemingly out of nowhere.
Just when Perez thought he had him right where he wanted him, Koloff was able to turn that around and lift him high to the air. But I tell you, Koloff, a little slower getting to his feet. Again, the quickness of Perez. And the way he was able to bounce by gave him the advantage at this point.
Al Perez is relentless. He will not let up for 1 minute. Certainly well-schooled, certainly a great athlete, but you can always better believe that when Nikita Koloff is in a match, he is always in a match.
And fans, the action like you've seen tonight. That's what you're going to be seeing this summer with the Great American Bash when it gets underway on June 26th. Also, let's don't forget Tampa Stadium on July 6th. What a night that's going to be.
Live on the Superstation, Koloff trying to sunset flip, and what a move. Perez just backpedaled using the momentum, got tied up in the ropes. No sunset flip coming right there. Great counter move by Perez, and now has him in the corner with a shoulder. Look at Koloff, it's stunning.
Oh, you can hear the air just leaving Koloff as he got that shoulder hard to that midsection. Now Perez, oh, he's going to try to suplex him. He can't get it up.
No, Koloff, I said, every time he's in a match, he is in a match. And reverse it, a vertical suplex. Koloff, who is weary also, but Perez is stunned. Both men trying to get up once again.
I'm sure that Perez really didn't think Koloff would have been able to do that. Good block.
Koloff with the right hand. Maybe Nikita getting another win. He caught the foot. He caught it right out of the air.
Uh-oh.
A vulnerable position for the Latin sensation here. Wheels him around and knocks him down.
Boy, to the other side. Of Perez, there was a look of fear when Koloff had that foot up. He knew he was completely at Koloff's mercy.
And he is being just laid out right here in front of us. A chain was wrapped around the fist of the Western States champion, Larry.
Fantastics were, of course, in Houston, Texas last night. I know I had a big party with Dusty Hill and ZZ Top, good friends of the Fantastics. That little rock and roll band from Texas, ZZ Top. Of course, Houston is their home. The Fantastics taking on Joe Cruz and the Grappler here on World Championship Wrestling.
You know, before the match goes underway, hello to Granny Louise Bevan, who always sits front row at the Omni. Every match, we understand she's in South Fulton Hospital, recuperating from a knee injury. Granny, get well soon. Want to see you back at the Omni. And fans, for television reservations, here's your number, 404-761-1780. Our next TV taping will be Saturday morning, 1 week from tonight, Saturday morning, June 18th.
You know, Tony, as we reflect back on this program, something that Kevin Sullivan said earlier in the program really stuck in my mind. And he was talking about all the things that he had done with Patty. You know, she's ridden in his car, she's cooked his meals, she's done this, she's done that. Several personal things. You believe that? You believe him?
I don't know. You listen and you're really not sure if you really believe all what he says or not. He has said a lot of things here on the Superstation that have come true. I'm not sure.
Well, I'll tell you something.
I want to hear the other side. I'd like to hear Patty say something. She does not deny a thing. She does not talk. You know, if what he's saying is not true, why doesn't she say the opposite to us?
That's a very good point, and I just can't see those two together on a social basis. It just doesn't look like any match made in heaven to me. But Kevin Sullivan, as bizarre as he is, I'm sure we'll expand on that again next week. But right here, the Fantastics, great belly-to-back suplex by Tommy Rogers, who possesses one of the greatest drop kicks in wrestling today. He really gets up in the lights. Tag is made. Double team. That knee lift almost took Cruz out of his boots here. And I'll tell you something, these guys, these two kids, are really humiliated. Speaking of Bobby Fulton here last week, after Jim Cornette got in his face, slapped him around. Of course, Cornette will tell his buddies, you know, Chasworth Osborne Jr., somebody at the club, how he beat up Bobby Fulton. And, of course, he might not mention it. Fulton had been hit right in the face with a steel chair by Bobby Eaton, and he had a straitjacket on.
Now a hard slam. Fantastic. Certainly one of the top tag teams in the world. Now we're going to take a look. I'm going up top with a Fantastic rocket launcher. There it is, Jim Ross. The Fantastics.
Tremendous team, the reigning United States Tag Team Champions with a rocket launcher. Great move here. And we're going to be talking to Tommy Rogers and Bobby Fulton here in just a few moments here at ringside, Tony.
And more information about the Great American Bash also next week. Okay, Jim, take it away.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, here with the United States Tag Team Champions, Tommy Rogers and Bobby Fulton. And guys, you've had a week now to reflect on the situation that happened right here in the studio. What are your thoughts, Bob, on this situation?
Well, let me tell you right now, Mr. Ross, you know we've known you for a long, long time. And you know that we never back down from anybody. Darn it, this is what you want. But we got something else for you. Because I want to see how you can handle it. I'm a man. I can take it like a man. But you're a mouse, Cornette. You and the Midnight Express are through. I hope that somewhere in that Great American Bash that there's enough people to pull the Fantastics off. Jimmy Cornette and the Midnight Express. Because Cornette, step in the ring. Try to be a man. You're not going to be the man that the Fantastics are. Midnight Express, you be prepared for the beating of your life, because we got something coming for you, brother. Ajax won't be able to take off.
That's right, you know, Mr. Ross, there's words to describe Jimmy Cornette, but not on public television. We come out here last week to show all these people what a straitjacket what Jimmy Cornette was going to be in. He wasn't supposed to be in the same studio. He wasn't supposed to be in the same state. But he showed up. That shows what kind of a liar, what kind of a weasel Jimmy Cornette is. But Bobby, he took a chair that no man I've ever seen take. So he's got more man in his little finger than Bobby Eaton, Stan Lane, and Jimmy Cornette do in their whole body. I took it to the throat, and I still got up. We're still here. So Jimmy Cornette, when it comes time for that straitjacket match, and you're up there in the air, and we beat Jimmy Cornette, and we beat the Midnight Express, and you come down, Jimmy Cornette, just think what we're going to do to you. Just think. I want you to sleep on it, brother, and sleep on it good.
Join us next week, ladies and gentlemen, for more NWA action.